when her husband decided to sell the pâtissier of Soutine, that she said to him, okay, if we have to make money now by selling, start selling things, I can better open a shop myself and do things. On the other hand, I think perhaps she might have felt that the moment had come that she wanted to show the world what she had been doing. You know, there's perhaps a certain point in life when one says, also, I mean, Soutine died and there was the war. There must have been terrible moments in her life, and perhaps she needed suddenly to show her style, her way of seeing things, and coming more out of her cocoon, because she had always been very protective of her private life, and suddenly, well, she was suddenly having what the French call pignon sur rue. She opened up to the public and said, well, this is the furniture I like, this is the colors, that's how I see a house. And that was it.
She found a place named the Lavanderie of Madame Sangène, the famous personage of Napoleon time, and she cannot resist. And she started to propose the decor.
A nice location and easy, and it's when you arrive at the Left Bank, you pass by this street all the time, so it's very nice. Low ceiling, a different room connect, lot of room connect, 1, 2, 3, 4. And each room is a decor. Donc it's fantastic, parce que you have, each day Madeleine arrive at the end of the day, she sits on the shop and she receives the people. It's like a salon.
The shop was painted black, and then she had very jealous colleagues, you know, saying, oh God, I mean, it's going to be a funeral parlor. They weren't accustomed in those days to have these dark, dark fronts of an antique shop.
What's the reason of the success of Madeleine immediately for the first shop? Because she don't make a shop. She make a real interior. And the people can see on the window a real salon. And she changed all the time. You know, one day is a bedroom, one day is a bibliothèque. And before, the shop is a shop. And that is not. It's like you see inside the room. You know, the people love that. That is an idea of Madeleine.
She knew how to sell things. I think she did it very well. If you came to Madeleine Castaing's shop, I mean, you knew she could say, I don't sell anything. But the miracle could happen that she could suddenly say, you know, I mean, it's okay, I mean, you can have this. But the prices were quite astronomical always. So I think in a way, I've always suspected that she was an artist creating an environment. She created an environment, and she didn't want to disturb that environment. In a way, her shop was something like saying, look, this is my style, this is the furniture I like, this is the object I like, let's try and find the same thing for you. But I don't think she was interested in selling.
I can show you the chandelier of Madeleine. You want to see the chandelier of Madeleine?
Yes, that'd be great.
That is the chandelier of Madeleine Castaing, this one. This chandelier is in our bedroom.
Beautiful.
Nice, no? That is typical of the taste of Madeleine.
I mean, as early as I think the 1920s, she started hunting for furniture. 1920s, of course, was 25, the epitome of Art Deco.
Oh, she bought things in the fly markets, or, and the most of, in England.
She finds in the Provence, in the free market, in England, she brings, she has a huge reserve, and she arrives at the reserve and she picks up like a painter with a coloration.
And then, I think at the time, Madeleine went a lot to the Marché aux Puces and found very inexpensive, I wouldn't say cheap, but very inexpensive items from the 19th century. I know for sure this is the truth. She had bought at the Marché Saint-Sulpice a Napoleon 3-foot stool or a pouf that was absolutely in tatters. It was ready to, you know, for the garbage can or something like that. But it was absolutely exquisite, and she saw it. It was with all the tassels were in tatters and the whole fringes and all this sort of thing. And she bought it really for a song. And the moment it hit her shop, and the American Harris came in and said, how much? Bought it for 500 francs, and she would say 55,000. And if people would be shocked, she would say, but can't you see it's the epitome of Napoleon III? It's the pouf. It's not something like that. Look at the wonderful deep buttoning. Look at the wonderful period, original tassels. And she would be right. Because it's not very easy for a woman to open a shop and become such an icon. I mean, she must have had a terrible inner strength. I mean, there was a little general inside her. Also, her health was really something quite amazing. She must have been very, very strong. Tiny, but tough. That's what she was. She lived to be almost 98. I mean, she died, she was born in 1894 and died in 1992, I think. I never knew when her birthday was, but she must have been about 98, and she was very proud of it. Nothing more wonderful to hear her say, je suis dans ma 92e année, je suis dans ma 93e année, je suis dans ma 94e année. She always quoted it like big triumph. I'm still there, the old cat's still around.
I think she was better and better as she became old. Because she has not to prove at the end.
Passed away, Michel Castaing, her son, was very nice to us and said, you could come to Lev whenever you like.
Well, the first time we did the photography was Michel, who gave us permission to photograph when the house was before the sale, so the house was still intact. It was perfect condition, but everything was there, the furniture was there. And the second time, it was Frédéric, son, who gave us permission after the sale, after the house was emptied. And that was quite, for us, was quite a shock, I must say. To see the house, you know, without anything, and the mattresses on the floor, but it was very inspiring. And I'm very grateful that he gave us permission to do it, because I think it's perhaps even more important than with the furniture. I think it was very inspiring. But it was a little bit, I don't say creepy, but she was, I think she was still there. She was still a little, very sad, but she was still there. And it's a pity that it's all gone. The house is sold, and the mountains are in the four corners of the world. But well, that happens, unfortunately.
She was a real artist. She wanted to. Real artists really want to change the world. And she wanted to change the surroundings. She didn't want to go on forever.
She knows that life is what you have inside of you, and not what the time is giving to you by fashion.